Good afternoon. My name is Umesh, and I work as a principal consultant at ThoughtWorks. And my colleague Mushtaq is a Scala geek. So last several months, we have been working on this very interesting project called 30-meter telescope. And we are building core infrastructure services and common frameworks for the telescope software. And one of the first things we built over these months is a service discovery mechanism. And that's we are going to share some of our learnings of how we could use CRDTs to effectively build a service discovery mechanism. Quickly about ThoughtWorks, I think because a lot many people are here who are thought workers, maybe I can just quickly skip through this slide. But we are around 4,500 people across 15 countries and 42 offices. We are from ThoughtWorks Pune. We are doing this project from Pune office. So a quick word on 30-meter telescope. This is going to be one of the largest optical telescopes when it's operational. So it's going to be operational in 2027. As of now, that's the plan. And when I say largest, what it means is the size of the primary mirror of the telescope is 30 meters in diameter. The current largest that's operational is 10 meters of the mirror. So building telescope of this size, having this mirror of this size and operating it is a huge technological challenge. A lot of hardware that is getting built, even that is getting built for the first time. No one has built, for example, a mirror of this size. So this mirror is going to be made up of 500 mirror segments. It's not going to be single mirror. And you will have actuators and controls for controlling each of that mirror segment. And a lot of that is experimental, like people who are building it are doing it for the first time. There are five countries who are involved in building this. So it's a consortium of five countries: US, Canada, China, Japan, and India. And software development is primarily happening in India. So let's look at the logical architecture for which we built this service discovery mechanism. Right. So as you see in this building, right, this telescope is going to be a huge structure. So it's going to be like a 4- or 5-story building like this one, with an aperture on the top, which will have that mirror for the telescope. And obviously to operate a telescope this large, there will be hundreds of hardware controls that you need to have. So if I just talk of logical architecture in terms of layers, at the bottommost layer, you have the hardware controls with embedded software on them and each having its own proprietary protocol to control that hardware. To talk to this hardware, there is something called as hardware control daemon layer, which is similar to device drivers. So each hardware control daemon will be built specifically for a particular hardware, and on this side, it will talk the proprietary protocol for that hardware. And it will expose programmatic interfaces for upper layers to talk and control this hardware. Now above this, this is more like aggregating layer, which is called as assembly layer. To give you an example of this, telescope has a subsystem called as laser subsystem, which is used for forming an artificial star in the sky for calibrating the telescope. And that subsystem has 6 laser devices, which need to be controlled. Now, in terms of the hardware and its CDs, you will have 6 devices to be controlled at this layer. And you will have 6 hardware control daemon instances running for controlling each of that. Now, to control this subsystem as a whole, this laser control subsystem, you will have a laser control assembly to which the upper layer, upper operational software will talk to control this laser. Above this, we have something called as a sequencer layer. And sequencer is to control multiple subsystems. So when you schedule a telescope observation, you need to operate on a telescope as a whole. So you need to move a telescope, calibrate, then take pictures, and all of that are steps that you need to program. And that's what happens at a sequencer layer. And then you have application through which you control all of this. So this is how the layers, and these are the components. Above this hardware, all the components are built on JVM. So they are Java components. And because the communication between all these components is asynchronous message passing, so they do maintain state, for which is device specific state, and it's not synchronous, so it's asynchronous message passing. So actors was a very well suited way of building these components. So these components are getting built as Akka actors, because it needs to be on JVM. And one of the key requirements for this was if you need to talk to any one component needs to talk to other component like a character, it needs to be discoverable. So the IP address and port, you should not be keeping any configuration. So if a particular actor or a device restarts on a different port, it needs to be discoverable at runtime. So there needs to be a zero configuration. And this is a very common requirement if you are familiar with microservices, right? I mean, microservices, primarily in the container world, you need to build something like service discovery mechanism, and most container frameworks give you that. So we had to build something very similar, but slightly different, because we also were using actors, and we needed to restore actors. So let's look at some of the common requirements that your service registry, yeah. So we'll cover that subsequently.
Actually, the first half of the talk is giving the context and comparison, and second half we'll focus on
the CRDT specific solution. So we are just building the context on what the discovery mechanism is, and how then the second half we'll see how CRDTs can solve that. So for building service registry and having a service discovery mechanism, you need to fulfill these common requirements. Any service registry or a discovery mechanism needs to have. First is it itself should have minimal configuration. So the registry itself should not have a lot of configuration that you need to have. It should be fault tolerant, because your whole system depends on the service registry to be operational. So there shouldn't be any single point of failure. You need to have health checks built in, because if you are figuring out what other services are available and their endpoints, you also need to know if they are healthy or not. And other important requirement is that of watches. And what it means is, when you look for a particular service, if that service is not available, you should be able to register your interest, saying, when this is available, notify me. Or if there is any change, like a service registers itself, but then it restarts and then registers a different IP address and port, anyone who is dependent on that service should be notified for that change. It should expose APIs so that services can self-register themselves using that API. If there are any third-party libraries or tools that you are using, like for example, we are using Redis or Kafka, let's say, you should be able to have agents which can register those services as well. And obviously, it should support not only actor reps, but all kinds of services, so HTTP services or just TCP ones. So let's quickly see, because as I said, this is a common requirement fulfilled by many frameworks in the microservices world. One of the common questions we get is, why not to use something like Consul or Zookeeper, which already solved this problem. And we did evaluate. So before moving to CRDT-based solution, we did evaluate all three of these. So let's very quickly go through how service discovery works in Zookeeper, HCD, and Consul. So Zookeeper, if you know, at the core is 3 to 5 node cluster of servers, which give you which form a cluster using a protocol called as ZAB. So that gives you fault tolerance and linearizable guarantees. If anyone goes down, you have values preserved in others. And then it gives you a file system kind of an API, which the clients can use for various purposes. And one of that can be service discovery. So to use it for service discovery, what you can do is when a service registers itself, create a node in Zookeeper, and you can have a parent node for each service type, and for each instance you can have child nodes. And then a client can look up using Zookeeper, Zookeeper client. The dependent service can look up using Zookeeper client. Health check is a bit rudimentary in Zookeeper. So the node that you create for a service instance is typically an ephemeral node, and what it means to be ephemeral node is till the point the connection from that service is open to Zookeeper, that node is present. The time the connection drops, node goes away, and that's kind of an indication that the service is not available. It's very rudimentary support. It does support watches, so all the three frameworks do support watches. But watches are, because this is client server, you have a separate set of servers which you need to talk to. Watches are implemented using long polling. So you need to have a connection open. So there is a watch request that you can make to Zookeeper. But you need to always have a connection open. And on that connection, you get notifications. So if for example, you watch the service one node, anything that happens, a new instance getting added or removed, you will get notified. Given you have a connection open for that. The second one is etcd, very similar to Zookeeper. At a core, it has 3 to 5 server instances forming a cluster, and it uses Raft protocol for giving you consistency. Again, it has a gRPC based client API, which clients can use to register, services can use to register themselves. And the core, it's not a file system API, but it's a file system kind of API. It's more like a key value store. And etcd is more popular because Kubernetes internally uses etcd for exactly this purpose, service discovery for Docker containers. And what it essentially does is you register using the gRPC API, and it creates a key value pair in etcd. And you can keep timeouts, so you can create a key value store, a key and a value with a timeout, and then it's the responsibility of the client to keep it alive. If it goes away, if it cannot keep it alive, it expires after that much time. And you also have APIs similar to Zookeeper for lookup and watches. Watches here are slightly more optimal because it's gRPC. It works on HTTP2, so you don't need to create multiple connections. On a single connection, you can have multiple watches. The third one is Consul. Now to start with, it again has very similar architecture at a core 3 to 5 node cluster, which is Raft based. What is interesting in case of Consul is it also has a concept of agents. And your services deal with agents to register themselves. So either you can use an API to register, or you can have a configuration file and an agent on behalf of the service registers that service. It also has a concept of health check built in. So you can register health checks, which Consul can use to determine the health of the service. And it has lookups and watch interface as well. Watches, again, because this is long poll, it's because it's remote client server, it's based on long poll. Now, interesting part of Consul is the way agents and server form a cluster. So across servers, the consistency is maintained by Raft, But agents and servers together form a cluster using something called as a gossip protocol, which is serve. And gossip protocol is a very common protocol that is used in clustered applications for maintaining group membership list. So in Consul, if you know it, I mean, you know about all the services, but you also know the state of all the nodes, if the node is alive or not, or which all node are part of the cluster. And that information is propagated across the cluster using the gossip protocol, which is serve. And on the service registration, the service registry is kept on the server. But what is interesting is that because Consul is used for other purposes than service discovery, like keeping configuration and all, you need to have this central registry. But if you just need to have, yeah, sure. It is a key value store. Yeah. I mean, it's a key value store on top of which you build service registry. But the core usage of Consul is not just service discovery. I mean, you can use it for other purposes, like keeping application configuration as well. But if you just need service discovery, right, keeping information about services, and that needs to be propagated across the cluster. If you have something like gossip, right, which Consul already has, Consul use, like the node information is propagated using gossip protocol. If there is a user API that is exposed and that is available to you at application layer, and your application can form a cluster where you can keep your own information that can be propagated on gossip, you probably can build service discovery or service registry on top of gossip. And that data structure that you need for doing these kind of things is CRDT, essentially. So Consul, HashiCorp has a library called as member list, which just gives you this serve implementation. And it has a very, it doesn't have a exact CRDT support, but it has a broadcast support. So you can keep application specific data, which can be propagated across all the nodes. And because we were using Akka has a concept of a cluster inbuilt. It's a very very good support for clustering. And on top of that cluster, it has CRDT library that is also very well. That's also very good, called distributed data. So we could use distributed data on top of Akka cluster to implement something which is very similar to Consul and which worked very well for us. So Mushtaq will talk about that specific implementation.
So before we go to CRDT, I think in my words, I will just say what is the intuition. Intuition is that if whatever mechanism gossip-based cluster of Consul is using to maintain its own member list is available to you as an application developer, then you can keep your own member list, which will be your services. That's the intuition. And then it's if you just read up, you will know that in any gossip-based cluster, the membership list is kept consistent or eventually consistent using a data structure, which is CRDT. Whether you call it a CRDT or not does not matter. That was the case with Akka, but then Akka moved ahead and actually provided the same mechanism that they're using to maintain the cluster list as a library. And we are going to talk about that library. But before we do that, let's revisit CRDT. How many of you heard CRDT in the keynote in November? Okay, so you registered that. It's an interesting Erlang community championed this idea, and it's getting popular in all gossip-based clusters, and we'll see why. But to understand what a CRDT is, based on the definition, they are generally a conflict-free replicated data type, which means if your cluster has 10 nodes, the information that you are trying to update and get will be replicated, all of that, across the 10 nodes. That's the meaning of it. And the meaning of conflict-free is that there will be a mechanism to come up with the same list across the nodes, which will not involve conflict. And it will not require a coordination. For example, Raft is a coordination-based system. It values consistency. So coordination will give you a consistent set of values. But here, you can do it without coordination, And why, how is it possible? Because the operations allowed on these data structures are very, very restricted. And that restriction is defined or enforced by them requiring to have a merge function. I think briefly we talked of merge function in the talk. Let's see what it is with an example. Right? Again, to build an intuition, set is a, I can say, is a CRDT. And assume that if you have a three-node cluster, which allows add operation, add of members, services, whatever you call it, and each such operation is allowed concurrently on different nodes, at some point in time, you will have different data. So in the first node, you will know about AB, and on the last node, you'll know about B, and so on, right? So you are looking at different data. If you query at that point for a set value, or check if a value is present, you might get different result on different nodes. But we also know that the reason we chose set as an example is because it has some interesting properties. Like, it has a union function, and all of us understand set union intuitively. That set union, if we apply basically n number of times, it gives you the same set. Right? And set union, if you apply in any order to three sets, it will give you the same value. And using that principle, you can be assured that eventually all these nodes are going to see the same set of information or membership. This union function, which is available on a set, is called as a merge function. Why? Because it has certain properties that are essential. And those properties are associative, commutative, and idempotent. I mean, those are the terms from algebra, but just for intuition, it means that if operation is associative and commutative, then order does not matter. Which means, if I'm getting, in a large cluster, I'm getting basically a union operation coming via two different routes. In one case, I will receive your information before his information, and that should be all right. That should give me the same result if the sequence was reversed. So it is essential that union function, which is a merge function, is associative and commutative because we don't want to care about the order. We want to be order independent. Same thing for idempotency. So if these operations are performed multiple number of times, then why will that be a case? Well, this is a cluster with not a reliable delivery, which means some messages will be dropped, so there won't be acknowledgement, so they will be tried again, so there will be duplicates. And set union has a property that duplicates does not matter, which is called as idempotent. So using these three properties, we can ensure that these sets will eventually converge without coordination, will converge. So that's the intuition of the CRDT. CRDTs have few types, as you heard in the morning. That's not the focus, but I'll just, for the bigger context, I will mention that and then we will do our example. So the first type of CRDTs are commutative. CMRDTs, they are called. They are operations based, which means that the operations, chain operations which happen on the data, only the operations are propagated to different nodes. State is not propagated. They are a little bit less constraining than what we saw because they do not require the idempotents, which means they do not require idempotents, but on the other hand, they require a reliable delivery, which means that it's essential that you get a message exactly once. But, right, so you can get the message in any order, that is fine, but you need to get exactly once. And because you are going to get the message exactly once, you don't have to apply that again and again, which means if your operation is not idempotent, that is fine. But your operation still need to be commutative because you can get them in any order, right? So it's slightly less constraining to have a data structure, and this kind of data types have a very important role in building the event source system, right? Where you want a bank account to be available in the network partition across two data centers, but then it should be able to merge. And you still want meaningful operation to have, not a very convincing operation like just a add percent. But there are other types of CRDTs. They're called And they're constraining because they require all three properties that we saw earlier. Because they do not enforce a reliable delivery. They do not enforce on the protocol a reliable delivery, and that's why they work very well with the gossip protocol. And then we are talking of Akka-Cluster, which is based on the gossip protocol. So the data types that we are going to talk about are basically CRDTs, which are as part of Akka library called as distributed. One small thing, even though you pass the entire state, in service registry, your services will be few hundred, so the state is not there. On top of that, there is an optimization called Delta CRDTs, which try to basically pass the minimum information, right? Only the changed information, the changed state to the other nodes. And that support is available. So we are using, we are going to use Delta. Now this is just a list of CRDTs which are available in the library, like counters, sets. The first three are the primitives, counter is easy to explain, set is easy to explain. Register, let's focus on LWW register. LWW is last writer wins register, which will, if there is a decision to be made, which if you are updating the same value, then the decision will be made based on who writes later, and that value will replace the existing value. In case of service discovery, that is fine. If you want exactly one service to be associated with, in some cases, you want multiple instances of services to be associated with the name, which is a usual case for, say, Docker and Kubernetes and all that. Then you can use a set against the name. But in our case, telescope, we want exactly one instance of a hard disk to be available. So we are using the register. The last one is a composite data type. So CRDT is actually composed because of these algebraic properties. And what is possible is that you can have a CRDT map where key is a key, a string or some value, but the value of the map could itself be a CRDT. And if you do that, then you can actually create the whole map and give it the same characteristic like the underlying value. That's a very nice property because of the algebraic operation. So we are going to use one of that, which is LWW map. It's a map where the values are registered. Now the question is, why are we using two and not just one CRDT? We'll come to that. So we have two very distinct requirements. One requirement is that I should be able to watch a particular service against the name and get all the events, not only when it comes up, but when it changes the port and stuff like that. And that is supported currently in Akka only at a CRDT level. So I cannot say that of this whole map, I'm interested on only in one key. That is not supported. So I have to keep a register separate as a top level entity. But then there is another requirement that at any given point in time, I should be able to query and find out and list all the services in my system, or maybe filter them. Well, if I'm just holding all the top level values, I have no way to do that. So I need to put them inside another data structure, which is our L. So that is the constraint that we are working with right now. So we have to deal with obviously, each add and remove operation of a service will involve changes to both the CRDT, and that poses some challenges. So before we go to the implementation, let's see how it looks in the bigger picture. So these are the three nodes that we are talking about, which are forming a cluster, and they are three different machines, right? Each one having a JVM instance. JVM instance of a telescope related software. Now it's not required that each machine has a single JVM instance. They can have multiple, and they are going to have the real topology. But then each JVM will participate in the cluster forming. It's unlike Consul where there is one agent. On top of that, we have this location service as our library, CRDT based library, on top of Akka cluster. It forms a ring, basically, a gossip-based cluster. There is a way to discover this cluster. We'll not go there, but we'll talk in the last slide. And then on top of it, you have a CRDT copy of your location registry. So basically, registry is replicated on all this array. But interesting thing is that all of this is within the same JVM process. If you take this interesting picture, this is one JVM process within which the Akka cluster process which is started, and also a registry, which is a in-memory copy of that registry is available to the application. And that has very interesting implications. So now let's see how this registry is accessed. Well, we said that we have to support ActorRef, TCP, and HTTP. So let's talk of ActorRef first. Assume that the first machine is going to have three different actor systems having n number of actors. Each one needs to be associated with the name discoverability. They can directly call the CRDT based API that we have provided, that we are going to demo, and do the in process call. So, like application, I'm building an application, I get a handle with the library like a Java API, I make a call to register myself or discover someone else. So, that's important to keep in mind. That is also true if you are able to create a JVM based HTTP server, for example. We are using Akka HTTP. So we create the Akka HTTP instance, call the main method from there, but after it is started, we register it with the location. Because again, it is a local copy. That will not be true if I am starting Redis, because Redis is an external process. So to bridge that, you have to create an agent, JVM based agent, that will run within the process, and on behalf of Redis, will do the registration and registration and keep a track of the process running. So that is the utility that we have. So that's a full picture how internally it works. And based on the discussion so far, we can see or discuss some advantages that we can debate. So the first one is that we are required to use Akka-Cluster, because that's the architectural choice. So on top of that, if for service discovery we had gone for anything else, we would have to have set up another, for example, Consul will require a setup of a Consul cluster as well as DevOps work around the Consul cluster. So we really bypass. Plus, what we get is an in-process library, which is not possible in any of the approaches that we saw so far. They were external, so gRPC or HTTP or a file-based API. 90% of our services are actors, and these actors have a very special way of doing serialization deserialization. It is as simple as string serialization deserialization, because they have a string based address. And that is available out of the box if you are using Akka and Akka distributed data, so we don't have to write any custom efficient serialization for the actor. That was a good benefit. Each of the actors, whether it is in RLAN or Akka, can be watched for the death, and if there is a death, then I get an event. Well, based on that event, something in the cluster can unregister, which is a death watch, and then doing a housekeeping work. It is possible because each actor reference is watching. That is like an added effort. Maybe Consul provides in some other way, but this is a direct support. And because the replicated copy of CRDT is present on all the instances, the most common operation that we do, which is a lookup, is basically very, very fast. It's like an in-memory call. We don't. So when we look up, we have. So CRDTs allow you to tune consistency. For example, we say that I'm just a local cache. Doesn't matter if it is slightly stale data, because then my call will fail, and that is fine. It is to an extent that each call that we make to remote goes first with a lookup and then call, right? And that is it's a no cost to us. So that pattern we would not be doing if it was. It's going to take few milliseconds, few hundred milliseconds, right? Then we'll cache it for a while and then and the last is that the watch operation, which is a subscription, is basically push based. There's no long polling involved. I just register my interest and the whole action messages are event based. So I keep getting the updates if the service goes up right now without having to keep a connection, dedicated connection to that. So which is I think pretty good. But there are challenges, and that is, first challenge arises because we are using two CRDTs. And there is no guarantee of atomicity across the CRDT updates. Which means, I'm successful in updating the first one, and then I fail for the second one. It's a partial success. There is no way to have it more consistent than that. So what do we do? Well, the workaround was simpler for us, because we just error out. We just return error response to the client, which is a hint that try again. And when client tries again, that is perfectly fine because registering operation is idempotent. So from the same host, you can register n number of times. So which means that in second, third, fourth, or tenth attempt, they will be successful. Well, it's not foolproof. If someone wants to, is a malicious user, right, and trying to break the system, they will. But given that it's an internal application, I think that's a good enough character. And in future, if Akka distributed data allows us to watch events across only for a given key in a map, then maybe we don't need two data sources. We just use that. The second thing is the whole thing is tied to the Akka cluster, which means you have to know how to bootstrap Akka cluster, which anyway is a cluster. Which means that you have to know what happens when a node crashes without cleaning up. Which means there is no way to know whether it is unreachable temporarily or it is really down. Well, you can know as an external party, but as a member of a cluster, you can never be sure because you never know whether it is because of a network partition or this is genuinely down. And if you try to make your own decisions in the cluster, then it can give rise to split brain scenario, which is common in all such non-master clusters. So the usual recommendation is that avoid automatic mechanisms of calling something down. But we did not listen to that advice, and what we do is actually we just, if for 10 seconds the member is not accessible, we call it down. And we don't care, even if there is a split brain, we don't care because we are using CRDTs. So if the partition heals, then the CRDTs will converge. But that is not the main reason. The main reason is that if there is a network partition, this is a telescope system. There are much bigger problems to be solved, right, at a hardware level, and it will not be functional just because our software is not working is the least of the problems in that situation. So it's very unusual to go with automatic downing strategy, but we have gone with that. So those are the challenges. Then I have a small demo. How much time? So I'm going to talk of registration, and then subscription. So which means that let's create two applications. Yeah. So I'm going to start these applications. So the service one, what is it doing? It's just watching or subscribing to a name and watching basically. Service 2, I am basically, by the way, this is how the API looks. You get a handle in memory, yeah, just like an API, and then you call a subscriber. There is no, so this is all the local JV calls, they are not local. And then what I do in the other process is that first I register an actor called A, after some time I unregister it, and then after some time I register on the same name, I register an actor called B. So I should see three events, that's the first. So the first one is a listener, the second one is actually doing the job. So once they will form the cluster, I have disabled the logs, but you would have seen that they form a cluster. And now they start seeing the first, second, and this is how it is. So this is a simple demo. The slightly more interesting demo is looking at hundreds of services. Just to give you a feel of the performance, right? For example, I'm watching, instead of one name, I'm watching 100 names. And instead of registering and unregistering against one name, I'm registering and unregistering against 100 names. To give you a visual impression, I'm introducing some delay there, but that's just for the demo. So how will this look like? So let's do this. And then let's go to this, which is event listener. Oh, which is actually going to create them. And then you will see that it's pretty, in less than 200 milliseconds, the batches of updates will be transmitted across the cluster. So you wouldn't even notice the difference. It's like, well, it's not real time because the CRDT updates are propagated in batches of a few milliseconds, but that is completely acceptable to the service system. And this is registering right now, and after it is done 100, then it will start registering. And you can do this concurrently with the CRDT. So I think that's about the demo. Yeah, so about the team, I think some team members are here. We are development from Pune from the but the project office which is driving the requirements is in the US, where PMP is situated. And then Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore is the Government of India channel through which we are getting. So those are the three things right now. And these are the links for, it's an open source work. So whatever we have done is on GitHub. It's also well documented because we are the library provider and some other device driver. So we are trying to document it. And location service is just one of the services we are building. We are building a lot of.
DNS service can provide you service discovery via the DNS, like it uses DNS 2782 records or SRV record.
So it's a standard, you can say, and many of these service discovery mechanisms are trying to provide a standard way, which is the DNS based interface. If we had gone with Consul, maybe we would have used it, but for us,
we could use this as a library. Extract this as a general purpose service discovery mechanism, then probably you need DNS.
If we want our library to be used by any general project, then we have to come up with some standard solution, and that is DNS.
DNS is the simplest one.
Consul also provides something called network tomography. And like, how many instances of your service, any given in service, do you have? Okay, so then you probably won't need that so much, because network tomography gives you latency between nodes, which is part of it's part of the SERP protocol.
Yeah, right. So I think I very cleverly just talked of add on a set because that's easy to explain. Because view is not going to work, right? But I will give you. As Martin he said that there's a notion of tombstones which are maintained with each entry. It's a very technical implementation, I don't fully understand, but I'll give you an intuition which is based on how counters are implemented. For example, instead of having just one set, if you have two sets, one where you keep only addition, one where you keep only removal, and then whenever you want to list, then you actually do a diff and then give you that, it will give you some of that function. Well, it will be not usable because then once an entry is removed, it can never be added. So it's not usable, but you get the picture. Right? So there are internal mechanisms to come up with very smart ways of implementing that and still giving you the guarantees which they are. Our register sitting as a value inside a map. So any operation that we do on that map is atomic, that is fine. But it so happens that we have to keep that register outside also, just for the tracking need. And then we are actually dealing with two. And the moment we wrap into a new one, I won't be able to track just the one value. That's a limitation of the implementation right now. But yes, once we compose them, then that will solve it.
Hi, thank you for the talk. You're using a last write when register and map. How do you determine what's the last value? If there are two concurrent updates to the same element, how do you determine what's the last?
It's not ideal if you just think from that. It's like very crude, right? Which it depends on the timestamps right now. But then timestamps are not reliable. But then now imagine that in our use case, what's going to happen is one SCD by design will be started on the we expect that that SIG, no other machine is trying to start that SIG. And now assume that by some mistake, two machines are trying to start the same device drivers, right? Any which wins, we don't care. Right? Will you, because I mean, they're like, they're starting the same code at the same. If they do mischief, if they say that against Galil, I'm giving you a device driver, and then someone is giving me, against Galil, giving me something else, that's a mischief. And that can happen, but then we are okay with that. That's but yeah, it's
Thank
a good
you.
Question. In general, last slide wins that too based on the timestamp is not a good strategy. If you want to do bank account handling and watching it.
Things are going toward more distributed systems. It is like CRDT joins.
This was on the multiple.
They joined officially Akka-Cluster.
Akka itself giving this kind of a library.
They are also giving?
Yes,
they
are using Akka distributed data. We did not write our CRDTs.
I thought that combine both your stuff and Akka-Cluster.
So we use the CRD library which Akka provides, and then we implemented a service discovery API on top of it.
Okay.
And our talk is about that how cool it is, right? So yeah,
but Akka is also I think it's Akka type giving a more service discovery like our rotation service. They have a
because they're also having like node failing stuff and something like that. They are working on it. Sure.
If you want the closest analogies, like the question is that is there anything is Akka cluster using the same mechanism for doing service discovery? Then that's a very very interesting question because Akka type, if you're following the type Akka type which is being developed. Akka type doesn't have so far a notion of a remote actor. So which means that it has a local actor or it has a clustered actor. Which means to discover a local actor, well, you have a reference. To discover a remote or a clustered actor, the only mechanism is service discovery. And they are providing a service discovery mechanism now inbuilt as part of Akka type. But it will work only with actor references. And that mechanism, they call reception. So if you just look at Akka type receptionist, you will see CRDT is being used for a very similar reason. And it came much later, basically, than
after
than
the
analogy. And there is another, okay, so we heard from Lightbit that there are some of their commercial